Thank you very much for being here. I'm Antonella Notari-Vischer. I'm the Executive Director of the Womanity Foundation, and it's really my pleasure and honor to welcome you this morning to this breakfast with a panel that is just absolutely extraordinary. And I think we'll have a very interesting discussion around media and women's empowerment. We are holding this event here in New York because it's our 10th anniversary. So happy birthday, Womanity. Jan started the foundation 10 years ago, and he will talk a bit more about that. I also wanted to tell you that we are tweeting on hashtag Womanity. If you wish to participate in that activity, you can find the stream there. Our handle is @forWomanity if you're looking for us. And now it's my real pleasure to introduce Brooke Baldwin. I don't think anybody needs an introduction to Brooke Baldwin, especially if you live in America. The Europeans don't have the pleasure to get to see her that much, but you see her, I'm sure, almost every day. Brooke has come from a brilliant career in journalism, covering local, national, international news, big stories, difficult stories, happy stories. I think you also cover Golden Globe and things that are more fun. But Brooke has also covered the Arab Spring, the bombings in Boston, and other burning, hot, difficult, and interesting issues. We are really, really pleased that Brooke accepted to moderate this panel because I think she understands also as a woman what it is to work in media, and she understands the issues that we will be discussing today. We are a bit focused on the Middle East and North Africa, not only, but you will see that several of the panelists have worked in the Middle East and North Africa, and that's an area, of course, where you've taken a lot of interest as well. So here's to you, Brooke, and thank you very much.
Good morning. Good morning. Hello, check, check. It is such an honor to be here. When Susan and Maura asked me to do it, I was telling them earlier, you just don't say no to these ladies. So I said, yes. A little bit about me. It's awesome being here. And I think as we're talking a little bit about a certain part of the world, I had never been to Africa. I'm 35. I'd never been to Africa until a couple of months ago when I finally got my butt in gear and went over there to go climb a mountain. So I recently summited Mount Kilimanjaro in Tanzania. So if anyone wants to talk to me about that afterwards, I highly recommend it. It's the toughest thing I've ever done. That's when I'm not on TV. I do host a two-hour show each and every day. It's a live show on CNN. So if you're in the airport or hopefully watching at home, 2 to 4 every day. I was recently parodied on Saturday Night Live. President Obama mentioned me in reference to that sketch at a dinner that I couldn't attend because I was being honored by women. So I said no to that and yes to the ladies. Yeah. Yes. But honestly, the biggest compliment I have ever gotten is when women tell me, they say, Brooke, you are such a woman's woman. And so I think I'm surrounded by a lot of that. And I definitely have three ladies you're about to meet who are women's women as well. We all have to bring each other up and stir it up a little bit. So without further ado, let me begin with the man who brought us all Swiss chocolate this morning before 9 a.m., which is awesome, who founded Womanity, Yann Borgstedt. Come on up, Yann. We'll get you guys seated. Let me bring you up. We'll get you guys seated, and then we'll each go through each person. Then from Syria, she broadcast a radio show to millions. She knows firsthand being a woman in the Middle East, being a woman in journalism. Right. Honey El Sayed, come on up. a capital J journalist. She was in journalism for many years, and in a sense, she is very much ever the journalist. She has been with Women in the World since the beginning. Congrats on the recent New York Times partnership. She is Kyle Gibson. Come on up. Kyle, executive producer of Women in the World. And a former journalist who I think this is just badass because she knows how to code. She is Sabrina Hersi, Issa, and she now serves as CEO of Be Bold Media. Come on up. I'll just go to this side. And I just want to each go through each person first, and then we'll open it up to our discussion. Then you guys start thinking of questions. And again, if you want to tweet, hashtag Womanity. So Yann, tell us a little bit about yourself first.
Is it working yet? Well, what can I say? Can you hear me? I decided to found Womanity about 10 years ago. I had the chance, you know, I sold one company and I said, you know, if life has given me so much, I need to do something with it. And the first program we ended up doing was in Morocco, where we realized that a lot of prostitutes and a lot of single mothers were former little maids, so girls between 6 and 11 who were employed as maids. They come from the rural environment and they go into cities. And that's when it all started. And then we met Sherry Blair, and we decided to transform girls' education in Afghanistan. So we took over the largest schools in Kabul with 6,000 girls to make it, you know, the big thing, everybody says, you know, you need as many girls as boys in school in Afghanistan, but the quality of girls' education was much poorer. So we decided to prove that girls' education had a value in Afghanistan, and we did that with one school, and then we got a big grant to roll out the model to another 13 schools. So that's a bit the story. Great. And then, you know, one thing leads to another, and we are.
So I think that's kind of amazing. Honey, tell us about what you did, where you're from, and why you're here.
I don't know if you have all day.
We've got some time.
No, I'll try to keep it short. First of all, thank you for having me here. I'm really honored. 5 years ago, I never thought I'd be living in the United States, but that was before revolution and armed conflict, proxy war, Islamic radicals dominating the narrative of Syria. 5 years ago, I had a morning show called Good Morning Syria for almost a decade that, like you were saying, had millions of listeners. And it was actually inspired by Robin Williams' Good Morning Vietnam, if anybody knows.
Are you serious?
That is
amazing. In Syria, you were inspired by Robin Williams.
Yeah,
that's phenomenal.
Yeah. I was very focused on what I term as positive media and, you know, focus on grassroots social cultural reform, since I knew I couldn't change the politics. Well, I could do work with the people. And I really believe in a bottom to the top solutions, not just top to bottom. Come the revolution, as a journalist, as you may know, I was forced to leave Syria and I arrived to the United States because I had a visa on my passport. And I've been blessed since I've been here. For a lot of Syrians who are forced to leave, you know, when you first arrive to any new country, you have, you know, two things on your mind. One, survival. Two, for most of us, guilt of survival, because you leave everybody back home. And you feel like the urge, you want to do something, well, what do you do? And there's that umbilical cord with everybody else that was in Syria and around the world, and I connected with them. We were four people who started Radio SouriaLi, two women and two men, and one of our first policies was 50% women representation. And today we're almost 23 to 25 people between freelancers and part-timers, full-timers inside Syria, Middle East, Europe, and actually there's only two of us in the United States. We are focused on psychosocial development, community development, and peace building. We're independent, we're a nonprofit, and we have the challenge of finding a middling ground in the midst of a conflict, because that's really difficult. It's a moral dilemma to remain objective, but not neutral would be the honest thing. Our programming is 24/7. We focus on marginalized issues, and through our programming, it's really working with Syrians and people from the region on advancing their level of awareness on concepts that are sort of new to us, like democracy, rule of law, transitional justice, reconciliation, women's empowerment, youth leadership, so on and so forth. And we do this through social media, online. We also have FM inside Syria, which is basically mobile transmitters, and we collaborate with FM carriers inside. And so we do face a lot of security issues there. Digital arts and, of course, technology whereby we have phone application and so on and so forth. We are not only focused on women alone, for sure. As I said, it's all inclusive. You cannot create a separate reality from the men. You want to create equality. And therefore, all our programming is very diverse in that sense. Of course, we do have a show, for example, that's focused on women. We've had the honor to collaborate with a Womanity organization on a soap opera called Bimit Ragel, along with many other international organizations, and that's about it.
That's amazing, and I have lots of questions for you. We'll loop back. Also, just being a woman in media, and especially in Syria, I have lots of questions for you. But Kyle, talk to us.
Is this on?
It's on.
First of all, I revere Honey. We met about a year and a half ago, and that she emblemizes what Women in the World tries to bring to our stage, storytelling about the issues of our time. I'm going to tell you a quick anecdote. The very first Women in the World, we prepared the agenda in 2009. We put it out 4 weeks before the event in 2010. This is Tina Brown and I. Our staff totaled 3 at that time. We were in this little tiny theater at Hudson Theater, but all of Tina's friends and people she knows were getting this agenda, and the agenda said, morning coffee, then rape as a weapon of war, followed by human trafficking, then female genital mutilation, then lunch.
Yikes.
And Tina's friends started calling her and people who cared about her passionately and said, what are you doing? We thought you were putting on a women's empowerment conference. What is this? No one is going to come. And of course, it was so close to the event that we had no choice. We'd booked these people. But Tina, being Tina, was also able to reach out to Secretary of State Clinton and describe to her what we were trying to do. And Secretary Clinton said yes, she would come. She's now come every year. Meryl Streep did a reading. She's now a permanent co-host. But here's what's interesting about that first year. The Monday after that summit, we had no idea what the reaction would be. And the reaction was the phones were, we were overwhelmed with calls. And the calls, with all due respect to Secretary Clinton and Meryl Streep, weren't about them. It was, what can I do for the doctor in Congo? What can I do for that woman in Senegal? For the imam fighting for human rights? Tell me what to do. You've got me. Now, this brings up two different issues, what we are and what we're not. My mission in life, as I told Brooke, is to hold on to the sort of journalism in which I was raised and that I practiced with the great mentorship of Ted Koppel for so many years at Nightline. One of my colleagues, Tara Sonnenschein, is here. The mission being that the story is an end in itself. Good journalism should be an end in itself. And if that's not clear to you, I almost don't know how to take you to the next step, which is it's about the mission of elevating awareness and elevating consciousness. And then what people do with that is up to those people. You're almost honoring your audience by saying, I'm not going to lecture down to you. I'm not going to tell you what to do. We're going to tell you some stories that we know to be true and we feel are relevant to all of us as a part of humankind. There have been studies since we began this mission that say if you want to affect change, go back to first-person storytelling. But I have to tell you that I don't get up in the morning and say, how can I affect change? It's just not the way I was trained. My mission is, what are the stories I can tell that illuminate something larger than themselves about where we are in the world? So what is Women in the World? Women in the World is not a conference, it's a show. And the other day I was saying, I hesitate to use that word because it sounds so superficial. But it is. It's a show. There's no Q&A with the audience. It's now at Lincoln Center. We're in our 7th year. We've done 6 now. And at Lincoln Center, we sell out. We do 3 days.
Sell out Lincoln Center.
3,000 seats, 18 hours of programming. And I have friends who won't speak to me because I couldn't get them seats. But we also had, as of this year, yes, we merged with the Times, took us in as a partner, which was a new thing for them, which basically gave us the imprimatur that we were what we set out to be, which is live journalism. We are told, and please don't hold me to this, but I'm told they've checked and checked and checked more than 5 billion media impressions this year, unique media impressions, and approaching 1 billion Twitter. All that matters, but what matters to me is that we stay true to the mission of illuminating the issues of our time, whether it's women from Syria, men from Syria, children from Syria, whatever the global issues that we think are the pressing issues of our time, what we are attempting to do is illuminate those issues and where they intersect with women. I don't say we are by women or for women, because we're also bringing men onto our stage. I think that, to steal from Hillary Clinton, the point is this: global issues are women's issues. Women's issues are global issues. We all know this. And my mission with Women in the World on this stage is to illuminate that. We're now taking this to, we'll continue at Lincoln Center every year. That's our anchoring event. We are now creating a new website on the Times. It's a work in progress, very thrilling for all of us. We're also taking this to London in the fall, to India in the fall. We've just been to Dubai. We're taking it around the world because we want to bring the issues from other places to those places. So when we go into India, it will be 70% not about India at all. We'll be bringing in some of the amazing women we've had on our stage and others we've found to illuminate best practices as practiced elsewhere. So it's a thrilling mission. It grows and grows and grows. I will confess to all of you, I tended to do it once. I'm now in year 7. It's taken over my life, but to point out what Brooke was saying, you can't dive in. I will also confess that I didn't set out with much interest in women's issues. When I came of age, I'm that old, at ABC News, to say you were interested in women's issues was to get ghettoized. I wanted to go cover war and conflict, and I did. But now I can say honestly and with the authority that we all have, again, global issues are women's issues, and it is my mission to illuminate them, but it is also my mission to urge all of you who are in the world of advocacy. Women in the world, we don't allow people to take a podium. We don't allow them to talk to audience in general. We want people to just listen to stories. But to those of you who are in the world of advocacy, I urge you to care about journalism as it once was practiced and is fading away, because I don't know how the people you are trying to reach are going to be informed in the way you want them to be informed without data-based, fact-driven narrative journalism. It starts there. Elevate their conscience and then get them. Sorry.
Preach.
I'm lecturing. Just no. What I said, no, I don't believe it.
No, I totally agree with you, and I think a lot of this is about storytelling, which we'll get into, and how you choose those stories, and the special sauce, and how you measure success, and bring about change. Sabrina,
yay.
Tell us about you yourself.
I am so awake after hearing this.
I know.
So, hey everyone, I am Sabrina Hersi. I'm from D.C. I think most of you guys are in New York.
Fresh off the train.
Yeah, fresh. Oh, really? Oh, okay. Kyle's stuff lives in D.C. She's mainly here. I really resonated, honey, your story, because my family's from Somalia. I grew up in the U.S. But what you said specifically about when you come to this country, you worry about survival, and then guilt for surviving. And I just knew growing up in this country that I wanted to build a career based off of service and to give back to the country that gave my family a second chance at a peaceful life. And that initially, that form of service was journalism. I was like, this is awesome. Because I felt like I was constantly growing up explaining the, you know, Somalia, Islam, the Middle East to my American community and trying to explain, popular culture to my family.
Sure, that's very, very easy to do.
The Fresh Prince does not translate well whatsoever. But I saw media specifically as an incredible tool to bridge cultural divides, to help people realize that we actually have way more in common than we have difference. So I joined, first I was in television news, and then I joined the wonderful world of public media, which after TV, like TV, you have 30 seconds to a minute and a half to tell a story. And I just remember at NPR, I was like, we have 4 minutes? Oh my God. Like you felt rich, like the time to be able to tell a great story. But after a few years, I realized that, and I didn't study journalism. I basically just learned on the job through really incredible mentors. And my background is international relations and foreign languages. And so when I was in public media, the war in Afghanistan was really just kind of hitting a major peak moment. And I just made this parallel. I said, Somalia is Afghanistan 10 years from now, and I want to be a part of rebuilding and reshaping the future of post-conflict reconstruction in Afghanistan, because I know it's going to happen in Somalia too. And I'm patting myself on the back for that foresight, because I basically called it. And I got a job working at an Afghan NGO that had an independent television and media and a radio station that was all my role was to train women and girls to run independent media in southern Afghanistan, kind of a dream job. And they also had an incredible education program and an incredible independent economic development program for Afghan widows, where they basically set up this incredible entrepreneurship center where they got to start small businesses. But they also, the widows and the mothers and the grandmothers brought their babies and their daughters with them. And then so we brought in teachers. So we also had a school too. It was kind of awesome and agile and iterative, and I was really happy to be a part of it, because I knew that there was such important work happening and it was all driven. And also, I thought it was hilarious because I was the only non-Afghan person doing this work, and they all looked at me. They're like, "You're black," and I was like, and I explained the whole story of like, "I'm from Somalia, I'm failed state," and you know, But one day when I was in the U.S., my boss came up to me and said, "Hey, I have all of these internet projects I want you to do, and can you do them?" And they included basically setting up an app for Afghan diaspora to be able to listen to the media that was being produced, and also like making a new website. And you know, she had just like a launch. She just kind of like rolled out a scroll and was like, "All the interneting, young person, you know you can do." And I said, "Yes, I can do." And I actually could not do. I did not know. In the newsroom, I was the internet person because I just by virtue of my age. But actually building apps and building tools, I actually had no idea what to do. So I left work early, flew to a local community college, bust into some poor woman's office who's like a counselor or something, and I was like, "I need to be enrolled in a programming course." And she's like, "Do you even go here?" And I was like, "I do now," because I also knew that you could just like apply and like get in, right? My siblings had gone there. And so she set me up to go join a programming course that started the next day. And it was an incredible, it changed the course of my entire career. I learned how to code. I learned how to build really complicated databases. I learned how to do that in really, in environments that don't have internet penetration. And I learned how to take media that was being produced in one side of the world and figure out really cool ways to beam it to all around parts of the world where diaspora, people like Honey and I, live, and we still feel deeply connected to the fate of our home countries. And so over the course of that, I did that, and I got more into using independent media and using media and technology as a tool for amplifying and spreading marginalized and underrepresented voices. So I got more deeply involved in NGO work. And it's really interesting. I was working for a media nonprofit, and I, like most former journalists, I had a real identity crisis, and I went to my boss and I said, "I don't know what bucket to fit myself in, because there's all of this disruption happening in journalism and in news and in media, and I didn't have a clear label for what I did." And I was like, "Am I a journalist? Not so much. Am I a tech person? Meh." And she said, "You know what, Sabrina? This is what this is. You are a person who stands at a border with your feet in two worlds, and you're constantly explaining one side of the border to the other, and until people understand that there's actually not two different worlds. There's one common world with one common humanity. And as long as you're using tools that you believe in to tell those stories and to stand at that border, you're going to be fine. It doesn't matter if there's a word for it, because what you're doing is actually innovation, and you're at a cusp, and it's scary and it's weird, but you just have to accept it and ride it, and it's like you're surfing." And when she said that to me, it gave me so much freedom to be like flipping tables and not really caring about fitting into a box and fitting into an industry standard, because we are reshaping the industry standard So one day I was working. I was like, cool, quit that job. I'm just gonna go do this border thing on my own. So I basically started a company that uses technology and media to fuel social change movements around the world, focusing on using helping people deliver services after humanitarian disasters, and to amplify human rights campaigns, and to amplify women's stories and voices. And so one day it was Ramadan, and my friend called me. It was very late at night, and you know you do not call people late at night during Ramadan. And I missed her call, so I called her back, and I said, is everything okay? And she's like, oh, and this was during the famine unfolding in the Horn of Africa. And she was like, okay, here's the thing, Sabrina. I have a call with basically of 200 Somali diaspora dialed in. I registered this thing called End Famine today. I actually have no idea what I'm doing, but I figure you do, so can you just jump on this call? And so she patched me into a call in which they were like, okay, so how do you deliver humanitarian aid? And how do we mobilize and organize ourselves? And it was a great moment because I finally got to connect different parts of my career of working on Afghan issues, on using independent media, on jumping into something, not really fully knowing what we're doing, and actually connecting people who are not a part of the mainstream media narrative when we talk about famine and humanitarian disasters and food insecurity. We actually don't talk about the families of those people who are outside of those borders who are still deeply connected to the fate of what's happening in there. So we were able to organize diaspora all around the world to basically crowdfund humanitarian relief.
Was this the beginning of Be Bold?
No, this was the beginning of End Famine, which Be Bold incubates.
Gotcha.
Yeah, and we were able to do that basically because we were Somali. Like, Al-Shabaab had thrown out all Western NGOs, a Western affiliate NGO. So we paired with a local partner that had local credibility. We paid for it ourselves.
Yeah.
And set of feeding stations, we were able to do that across every single year there's been another major humanitarian disaster, and we work with another diaspora group to activate and mobilize.
That's pretty awesome to be patched in on a phone call and somebody says, how do we end famine? And you're like, I have the answer. So I don't know what I did to land on the stage with these phenomenal people, but I'm listening to all of you all. And I just really wanted to jump into the Q&A. Now that you sort of have a sense of who each person is, I think most of us come from a journalism background. I think we all recognize the importance of a good story, right? Because you have to have that great story to draw people in to then hope for change ultimately. And so I guess my first question, and honey, let me just toss this to you, but I want everyone to jump in. I mean, for all your years in radio, how do you know who to choose, which character to select to then tell this story around, to draw your listeners in?
I'm going to be very frank. It's almost intuitive for me. So for example, and there's many ways in telling a story. You can create a story through a soap opera, you can create a story through an interview or interviewing somebody who's inspirational. It could be a comedy sketch, it could be the music, the kind of music that you actually play on the radio. So for example, we play music that's, you know, not your just hip music of every day, but we also play music of marginalized people in Syria, like Turkmen, Circassian, Armenian, so on, in the new radio, for example. One of the stories of how do you find, so I wanted to have a sort of a Dr. Phil on the show before the revolution, the old radio. And I went around to almost 4 different psychiatrists saying that I have issues. We all do.
What kind of issues? We should have brought it so far.
But what I was really doing is betting. And finally felt comfortable with one of the psychiatrists and said, would you like, you know, I have a radio show, would you like to come to the show? And he said, yes. So one time, two times, and what I really wanted to do is, it's all about being indirect. It's all about persuading and not instructing. It's all about engaging the audience and talking with them, not to them. Especially in a back home in the MENA region, and you all would know this as well. It's not just about a conservative society, but this is a, you know, repressed and suppressed society. So anyway, what I wanted is to just tell people, you know, it's okay to go to a psychiatrist. It's not taboo. So it was part of saying this is not taboo. And when the psychiatrist came in, he became so popular that every Wednesday he was on the show, and people were waiting for him. And this was an interactive 3-hour live show. He had 30 minutes, and sometimes it would run for an hour. People having issues, and he had to actually expand his clinic.
Because you picked him.
Yes. The important thing is, I just going to say why he was important and what he did that made a difference in our society. So I every year wanted to have sex ed in the morning.
In the morning.
And it wasn't your biology class, but it was more of the psychiatrist talking to people and saying, you know, why it's important to talk to your children at a certain age. It's not, as we say, haram. It's not a sin to talk to them about it, because they're going to pick it up from somewhere else, and you don't want that either. So let's, you know, and bringing the psychiatrist in is more like, this is a scientific. But what he was really good at is that he took verses from the Quran, and he took verses from the Bible, and he knew all the Syrian proverbs. So whatever he said in a scientific, or, you know, in whatever opinion I would give of sorts to back it up, he would back it up with something that audience would relate to. And that's why it resonated for a lot of people. So it's storytelling is in this, it comes in many ways, and that could be one of them. And to what you were saying, today it's the 140 characters. So it's really breaking news, and we do miss more narrative because it humanizes us as a people.
But I feel like you can also take Twitter, and that's another way to draw people in, at least.
You draw people in, but right. Yeah, definitely, it's very important. And that's why, like, SouriaLi, and which is the new radio right now, and SouriaLi, by the way, means Syria is mine, and that's ownership, and it means surreal, the way we feel about what's happening back home. Mm. We're on all social media. We need to be on all social media, be it Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, Google+, Instagram, Pinterest, you name it, we're on it. And that's important because we also want to be heard. And it's very difficult for us. We're blocked by the regime. We're most recently got blocked by Turkey and by Abu Dhabi. So that means we're doing something right.
No, it's okay, because that's a good thing.
And selecting the right enemies.
Right. And I mean, even thinking about what I do and having people on just giving us eyewitness accounts of what's happening in Syria, it's incredible how you can find people on Twitter. Obviously, we vet. But to your point, too, Kyle, listening to you talk about, you know, listen, people sometimes come in, you have the big draw because you have Meryl Streep on the stage, but at the end of the day, the people are leaving talking about the doctor from Congo. And you don't always know which person will really, boom, you don't know.
You never know. And it's kismet to a certain degree. I was thinking last year we did the Dalits, the legal rule of law and the Dalits in India, who are, as you all know, the untouchables. And we had a Dalit woman on our stage talking about how rule of law doesn't protect them. And we did it because we felt this was an important story to do. We hadn't done it. We think rule of law in itself is obviously a very important story. And interestingly, the response to that program was unbelievable, even to the point that one of our moderators, who was a lawyer, said, I actually didn't know that story. So it you never know. This year, we had the Yazidis. Many of you may remember, it went viral, but Yann Dakil is the only MP who's Yazidi in the Iraqi parliament. There was a moment when she started screaming in the middle of parliament, it's a genocide, they're taking our girls, do any of you care? It's this very uncomfortable video to watch because it just doesn't end, and the men all get just stand there and they try to shut her up and she won't shut up. And we ran that video right after a Helen Mirren interview on purpose. So Tina Brown's interviewing Helen Mirren and suddenly Tina says thank you, and we just start rolling this video. People think they're getting up to leave, or they just think that was fun to hear from Helen Mirren, and suddenly they're watching this video of this woman in the Iraqi parliament screaming. To your point, we had a captive audience, we had a full house. We might have anyway, but we knew it would be an audience that wasn't expecting this per se. And then as that video finished, we didn't edit it down. We made the audience sit uncomfortably through about 2.5 minutes of this, which in our world is...
You kind of want to make people feel uncomfortable just a touch.
Touch.
You want to have that visceral reaction.
Yep. And then lights up, and there's Vian sitting there. And I had a lot of people say to me, I'd heard about the Yazidi, of course, but I didn't know. And that's to your point, yeah. And the Syria issue, we try every way we can. It's a tough one, because I so look for those original, authentic voices from Syria. We had two girls we tried to get out last year, and I remember you were a lovely guiding voice in all this, but... Getting those authentic voices who have recently been there. We've had on our stage, I will say briefly, a young woman right after the Delhi rape who herself had been raped, and she sat in shadow and told her story about how the police didn't care. And we had a woman 2 weeks after she'd fled the cartels in Mexico where she'd been held as a slave, also on our stage, back to audience in shadow. And those grip people. Interestingly, that one, I heard from somebody in the corporate world who said, I will never forget the woman who'd been the cartel as a slave. And they said it wasn't just, and we had to have her in translation. She didn't speak English, and that's hard. But they said it was just that visual of her with her back to the audience in shadow because she was so afraid. They will never forget that image. So you don't know what's going to grab hold. And you just, it's instinct. And it's that sense that is this, one thing I do say is I don't want to put on the stage a narrative that I would call a freak show narrative. It needs to be relevant to a larger issue. It needs to illuminate a larger issue. And that's probably the one.
So then how do you take, Sabrina, to you, how would you take then these stories, some of what, you know, you find them based upon instinct, you sort of rock someone to their core, they're moved, they're walking on a Lincoln Center with goosebumps and they want to help. But then for all the people you want to reach outside of that immediate area, how do you really create that digital footprint? How do you move it on the interwebs?
It's interesting because I connect with both of you, and I think like a journalist where it's like you know a good soundbite when you hear it. But in movement building, it's actually you have to train yourself to go against that instinct and to take a lens of ethical storytelling and ethical story sharing, because at the end of the day, media is a business. And I'm in the business of building power. And stories should be owned and have agency of the people who are telling those stories. So to then practice ethical storytelling and ethical story sharing, and it requires an element of intentionality, of making sure they understand that, like, this is, if you are 100% comfortable, that is the prime objective. If you are 100% comfortable sharing your story, if there is a free, a full understanding, awareness of the impact of those words that will live online forever. There's a responsibility that I think, because this is a new field and a new online and digital and movement building is it's only in its infancy. These best practices are only becoming more and more prevalent, more and more in use. So to actually have storytelling and the impact of the storytellers at the center of the movements that you're trying to build is actually turning on the side the instinct that I have as a journalist to, oh, that's an incredible soundbite. I actually need to now turn that attention to this person and their humanity and make sure they fully understand the impact of those words and designing that. So living that, then translating that online, once it is, like there's a really great resource called the Center for Digital Storytelling, and they are really at the vanguard of this space of ethical storytelling and what have you. So now you figure out, okay, you have this incredible narrative, where do you want to find where you want it to live and where you want it to go? And you then begin with the end in mind for that. You figure out where the audience is.
Wait, what do you mean? What is the end? You begin with the end in mind.
You figure out what the goal is. If you want to build an online movement around somebody who was at Women in the World and had an incredible narrative and galvanized Lincoln Center, okay, that action then that you tell to the room, you would know, okay, where do I want these people to go? Where do I want them to direct their energy? Where do I want to direct their eyes? Where do I want to direct their attention and their heat? And a lot of times that's legislators, it's policymakers, it's foundations and resources, And really turning that into a form of power building instead of a form of just hot air, you know?
Yeah. And I want to get to power building, but Yann, to you, because listen, we obviously all want women at the table, and we want to shake it up, and we want to help bring women up and tell these women's stories. We want to tell all stories. And how can men? I mean, I love that you created Womanity and founded it, especially with the venture capitalist businessman background. You know, this is sort of the route you chose, and we're all grateful. But how can men help in all of this as well?
First, you can see I'm the only Swiss on the panel, and they gave me 2 minutes, and I did not use them. Well, everybody used more than so.
So floor is yours.
So, honestly, it's about doing. I'm an entrepreneur, I don't think, you know. Sometimes I'm thinking about we should do this and that. I'm in Afghanistan, I meet this guy called Reza, the guy who took most of the famous picture of Massoud, which is the general who was killed on September 10. The last guy fighting the Taliban, he told me, I'm training women journalists and I would like to do a radio. I love the idea. I said, we should do the same in the Middle East. And when I'm in Jerusalem, I send some emails to a number of people. I meet this woman who used to run a coexistence radio, Israeli-Palestinian. And we decided to launch a radio, you know? And I think that's what it is. Don't think, as an entrepreneur you go, sometimes you fail. And that's the key thing I say as a foundation. And I tell Antonella, if we don't fail enough, it means we don't take enough risk, and I think that's the essence, you know. We don't want to be recognized by what we've done, but probably by what we've tried, and it's about pushing the boundaries. And using media is, you know, it's the first radio for women in the Middle East. We tried to do it in Egypt during the Arab Spring. We couldn't do it because we never got the license. So one door closes, we decided that the guy who runs the project for us told us, why don't you do a radio fiction? 20 episodes about a young Egyptian woman and everything that happens to a woman. And we syndicate that in 9 countries, from Saudi to Syria. So it's the typical life. You want to do something, doesn't work, you try to do something else. So, you know, and why a man? I don't know. You know, I could have worked on other issues. It's just I'm a business guy. Half of my balance sheet is not used to the best way. My company will not, you know, be as productive, you know, if half of society is not given the same chances. Society won't be as productive.
You mentioned the F word twice, being failure. I recently gave a commencement speech where I outlined 3 failures of mine and how I have sort of overcome them. And I think that this is something that we all, we're not perfect. We stumble. And I honestly value the stumbling as much as the wins. And I would love to have you explain a little bit more about how you took the failure and learned from that and moved forward.
I have so many failures, so, you know. Antonella, which failure should I use, you know? I don't want to embarrass you, you know? No, I mean, you know, we launched, you know, olive oil production for women in Morocco, and we ended up, no, I have a better example. You know, we realized 60,000 little maids in Morocco, girls coming from the rural environment, put in a family in Casablanca and Marrakesh. Their parents being told, your daughter will go to school, but she ended up as a maid of the family. So we decided to send those girls back to their family and go to school. Actually, what we created is that some people came to us and said, oh, my daughter is in Casablanca, can I get this? We used to give a monthly stipend. So we actually created the problem ourselves because they actually came to
nice
us.
Nice job.
You know, so. What we ended up doing is instead of giving money, you know, we paid for, you know, for school supplies or for food. So, you know, sometimes, you know, when you think you do good, you actually create the problem. And, you know, as foreigners, you come into a country and you think you know it all, and probably you don't know it all at all.
Mm-hmm. As far as, so getting through the failures, the stumbles, the wins, getting it out on digital, I think one part of this is, you know, we tell these stories because we want to create awareness and bring about the change. But at the same time, as you're telling these stories, you don't want to handhold. That's sort of how I think about it. When I'm telling a story, I want the character or the story to speak for itself, right? So can you talk a little bit just about how this is advocacy work, but you're not pointing the finger? I'm pointing my finger at you saying, don't point the finger.
yeah, and you said the word advocacy, and I just rear back.
Yeah.
You know, it is This is such a, we talked about this the other day. I get very uncomfortable around this, but it's something we have to own. Because of this era of disruption, the media companies that were trying to practice ethical journalism, I would argue, have come up against a new time and a new economic imperative to pay your salary, my salary, anybody's salary. I will say this, that having worked a bit in nonprofits and for-profits, I do think that my experience, whether it was at ABC News or doing, or now with the New York Times and some other places, that the for-profit model in journalism can be the best for ethical, what I call ethical journalism, fact-based, yeah, non-advocacy journalism. But to your point, this is this intersection. I for a long time, I was pretty haughty about this because my feeling was, if I've ginned you up, if I've gotten you galvanized, I've done my job. You figure it out. And it's sort of to what Honey was saying. In part, I felt I was honoring my audience. Who am I to shake my finger at you and tell you what to do? And it also gets into the methodology of the outcome that I'm not going to be an expert on. We put Dr. Hawa Abdi from Somalia on our stage when she was an unknown, and she was talking about trying to build a civil society inside her camp. This is a woman who, in war-torn Mogadishu, started letting people sleep in her farm, and now it's 100,000 people sleeping there, and she started saying, okay, we've got to create, you know, elders, we've got to create rules, you know, all kinds of things that are about civil society. But what others would do in rebuilding Somalia with that information is sort of, I want to honor those who are then in that world. Mm-hmm. Who am I to tell the Somali culture what to do with this information from Dr. Hawa Abdi to rebuild Somalia? But you put it out there. I do think, though, that on my side, we have to own this more, that we do get people ginned up. And we do have to create, probably through your expertise, seriously, you are that wave, how we hand off that energy and what you call that heat in a way that's productive. But I, on the flip side, I don't want to corrupt my storytelling by trying to get to the end. Storytelling, great journalism by definition, I may hate a fact, but if it's a fact, it goes in there, if it's a relevant fact, and there are irrelevant facts. There is no such thing as pure journalism, there is no such thing as pure history, none of us are pure. If I'm showcasing Dr. Hawa Abdi, there's a reason I've chosen her. On the other hand, if there's something that went wrong in the building of her civil society or in any other story that we think is relevant, it's our job to get it out there. So let the facts inform the outcome. I used to loathe the word organic, and now it is my motto. It's organic. And anyway, that's where I come in on this intersection, which makes me very uncomfortable, but I have to own my role in it.
So as we are owning our roles, how do we know we've been successful, Honey? How do we know, you know, you talk about now the psychiatrist had to add a wing to his practice, and that's one example of how you know you're reaching so many people in that way. But beyond that, is it bill, like whatever the story is, bills passed, money raised, girls returned, what is it?
There is a big difference between my past in journalism before the revolution and after the revolution.
Huh. Why?
Because before the revolution, this was live. It was interactive. I was getting calls, text messages. They were at the door in the radio station. There were, you know, fans who came all the way from Homs to, you know, just say, you know, thank you, or you did this, or you helped me with that, or, you know, one of the things where you feel very responsible is when a female, you know, comes to the radio station and says, well, you know, I believe in everything you're saying, and I want to go to university, my parents won't let me, can you talk to them?
What do you say to that girl?
I can't talk to her parents, of course, and I say, please keep trying, but don't, because the responsibility comes, if she pushes too hard, they might do something to harm her, and I don't want that to happen. So there's not much I really can do. But that's one story. There are others who do come and say, no, we did go to university. I'm a lawyer right now. So on and so forth. So, and, you know, we were able to measure through, you know, statistics and so on, the listenership. But that was in a war zone. Today we're in a war zone. We can't measure what's on the ground. The only tools we have for SouriaLi is really, you know, online, Google Analytics, for example, so we know that reach. We do cover an area of almost 4 million people inside Syria in 7 different provinces, but will I ever know who's actually listening? We don't know. The only way we know is through their interactiveness through social media. What they write on Facebook, what they, you know, and that's the interaction that we can get from Syrians, the diaspora, and organically the region, because when we first started, priority was, this is for Syria. But, you know, with all the turmoil in the region, you know, the level of atrocities may be different, but the pain is one. So everybody's listening, so on and so forth. So we really can't measure, but what I can tell you is, up to now, what we know from online, we have 250,000 listeners, and it's an increasing reach every month almost. And this is the only anecdotes we can get is what people say to us via social media. One of the stories with Bimit Ragel, when we collaborated with Womanity, we knew a local initiative. This is really small. It's called Suriat, which means Syrian females. And they took some episodes of Bimit Ragel and were listening to it and then create a little debate between the women. So what do you think, you know, what Mona, which is the famous celebrity, said and so on and so forth. And they share these stories with us. We did this, we heard that show and so on. One of the other stories, and I don't know if you would consider that a success or not, but we had ISIS actually promote their page on ours in one of the women's shows.
What?
Yes. And another time we had a state-run...
Whoa, I'm still on that. Yeah. How did that work and why'd you do that?
Because they know that we're listened to, they know we're popular, they know I'm listened to as in, you know, a radio host and producer, and this was one of the shows I was hosting and producing, which was called World and a Half, and it was really focused on women empowerment and youth leadership. And they just posted, you know, their you know, link to their page with the picture of the flag and everything, saying, please do not remove this, come to our page. They just know where to go. They know there's a reach here, this is the reach that they want. And this has happened often. Another time was a state-run regime, basically TV channel, did the same on the same show as well, where they'd promote their links on our page because they know that we're popular now and that we are listened to. And another success that I, you know, since we are, you know, creating peace building and so on, is that we were able to get two warring factions to listen to the radio. We had somebody from the Syrian army actually post that this is, I'm addicted to your radio, and another rebel with the beard and the machine gun, that was his picture, profile picture, you know, writing, you know, this is a radio for all Syrians. So to get the two to listen to this, and remember the content is democracy, rule of law, transitional justice, women equality, so on and so forth.
And they're fully aware of that's your mission. And you had them both on.
Yes.
I mean, talk about just responsibility.
It is a big responsibility. But it's about, you see, media is transforming all over the world, but in the MENA region, very much so. And coming out of war, it's always about taking sides. So media is, in you, to your point, it's agenda-powered almost, and it's really difficult to be neutral and so on. More so when, you know, you come out saying, okay, what side am I on? And Syria is, you know, Syria is 50 Shades of Grey, not the book.
Or a little bit like the book.
Maybe.
Well, you do have sex ed in the morning, so there you go.
So, and I have not read the book. But it is, it's very complex. And trying to find a middling ground is, and trying to say, you know, this is what I want to do. I want unity and diversity. This is what we stand for. We want to bring people together. We want to, so that's where the storytelling and the content kind of comes in. And many people, Jan and all of you were saying, you know, radio was mentioned so many times. And that's because radio is so personable. It's your best friend wherever you go. You're not going to carry TV. And
do you feel the same way with radio, Jan?
Look, I believe it's a way to reach a lot of people.
Yes.
You combine it with social media, you have a big reach. So
exactly,
a combination.
Exactly.
How about success for you all?
But yeah, think about why it's so great to reach so many people. It's ubiquitous. It's everywhere. And one of the things that I was thinking when you were speaking, honey, is The fact that when we are building campaigns, our rule number one is that we design for the context of the culture that we're working in. And that usually means really tackling head-on huge disparities in literacy. So the fact that, like, you, interchangeably you were saying, like, our journalism, but you were also mentioning your Facebook page, and those are kind of one of the same. Yeah, but in certain cultures, there are huge, huge disparities in literacy. So, like, I know in Somalia, most women that are of a certain age, it's 82% illiteracy rate because it is a colloquial auditory, the language is passed on not through schools, it is because of a failed state, there are eroded infrastructures and the education system is not there. So if we're relying solely on social media, we're actually only capturing men's voices. So the fact that radio is something that everyone on this panel can agree is such a great tool, it actually flows back to the lack of the shortcomings of digital and tech. Like, you can't rely simply on just one tool.
I actually, let's hit pause on our conversation. I want you all to jump in. Yes, ma'am, in the turquoise.
How much do you all miss editors? And I miss editors in print broadcast, not as gatekeepers, because I think we don't want people to tell us what stories are good stories, but to catch mistakes, to catch factual errors, to make sure things aren't posted that have to be taken down and reposted. So one is, how much do you guys miss that layer of editorial, not control, but fact-checking? And the second is the ISIS question. Everywhere I go on panels, I'm trying to speak upbeat about the media and upbeat about dealing with gender-based violence, and inevitably somebody says, how do we counter the narrative of the violent extremists? And I never have a really great answer, so now I get to be in the audience and hope you have a really great answer.
Can I speak to the editor thing?
Yeah, no, on the editor issue.
I love good editors. I still write. I write for The Guardian, and I'm so hashtag blessed because my editor makes me better and makes me sharper, and I send her fruit baskets. Like, the people who we're on the same team, you know. As long as like we're aligned with that, like, editors are nothing but wonderful.
I'm gonna address both of these very quickly. One is, I talked about this before he came on stage. When I advocate for the journalism that used to be, it was what I'm advocating for is exactly that, the editorial function. My fear is that there's a generation that doesn't even appreciate what we mean by that. An editor is somebody who has had probably business in the field, has had experience in the field, and can ask you all those questions, Tara, that you're talking about. How do you know this to be true? Are you sure this person is really, really? I'm working for a great editor in Tina Brown. That's what she was first and foremost and always will be. And she, in fact, to the Daily Beast, one thing that she was doing there that I don't think people realize, as opposed to other famous sites, was she had editors. Every column was A, she paid writers, and B, she had them edited. It's an expensive proposition. That's part of the problem. I want to say quickly that a young woman challenged me, a Harvard-educated young woman, when she heard me talking about this, and she works for Foundation. She said, "Miss Gibson, what about bloggers?" And I said, "Are you telling me you think bloggers are journalists? Some bloggers are journalists, but you think that's true?" She said, "Yes. You don't need bloggers are doing it around the world." That tells me something that I can't even deal with. Now, I did want to say one thing to Carrot, to Tara's other question. I'm passionate about this issue of the counter-narrative on ISIS, and we're doing it almost to the point that people are saying, is this all you're going to do now? We're putting on our stage some astonishing people fighting radicalization through really in the grassroots way, and the one I love the most we had on our stage last spring, and we're taking her everywhere, is Dr. Edith Schlaffer. You might know her, Tara. Dr. Edith Schlaffer is well known at the State Department now. She is traveling the world creating mothers' schools, and through the mothers trying to create a counter-narrative down to the youth, where they have identified that this really does begin in the home, and you've got to have voices that these youth are hearing other than on their websites, and it really goes to parents and teachers. But she's literally working with mothers of terrorists And she's even been working with an imam who recruits for ISIS. And I just met with her last week, and she'd been in Indonesia meeting with his imam, because what she's trying to do is deconstruct how they're getting this done. And then trying to construct what, how do we create the alternative to this. I think what Honey does is an example of it. I think all the ways we deliver storytelling that is the counter-narrative, it's as old as human nature. People listen to stories. It's like soap operas. We talk, why is radio so powerful? Radio and television soap operas have turned out to be phenomenally powerful, in particularly for women, in elevating the idea of what women can be in the world. And it's a fascinating story in regions around the world, how soap opera is serving this. The point is, there are many techniques and ways and heroes involved in this counter-narrative, but there's not one way, and it does involve understanding the culture that it's happening in and working inside that culture, and that's part of it too. So,
great. Do you want to respond?
Yeah, I just want to say that media to civil society is like oxygen to fire. And there isn't one solution to something. But one of the things that I would advocate for, I believe in, and this is what I, you know, been doing over a decade, what my thesis paper at Fletcher was about, and it's, again, positive media. And if I were to define that, I would say it's the creative and strategic use of the arts amplified by the media and their interplay for positive social change, cultural dialogue, and peace building. This could be one of the ways, you know, that it is not the only solution, but it's one of the solutions to counter. Now, it's very important when I say strategic, and it is about knowing the culture. It is about knowing the people, the audience that you are targeting and engaging them. And it's a tool, and when I say media, arts and media, it's a medium. And it's a medium where you can communicate a message, where you can counter X, Y, or Z. It's how you do it, when you do it, and to whom, who's your target. So if we were to talk about peace building, for example, you know, even traditional peace building practitioners, so on and so forth, are recognizing that for sustainable peace, it's not enough to have cognitive and rational engagement. You need media and the arts to do that. Because in peace building, it's all about changing mindsets, societal behaviors, so on and so forth. Media and the arts helps do that through the narrative, through changing the narrative. And it's about, again, another thing is edutainment. So it's education, education, education in the home, in the school, through the media, because it's a social agent, it's a social change agent. So how do we use it is very important. Today, if we were talking about international or Western media, the headlines is ISIS, and it's what leads bleeds. We see things through the race and ethnicity, but it's not black and white. It's not the others. It's putting a human face on that and using those tools to counter.
Can I add one thing? Another aspect that it is this and, it's not just one single tool with countering violent extremism. And one of the things that hasn't been mentioned is the importance of economic development in that. I know with working with youth in Middle East and North Africa, it's like falling off a cliff once school is done. Like, where do you go? Where are the jobs? So actually having a intentional interventions that there's an economy that people can work in after they're finished with their primary education is an incredible deterrent for violent extremism.
What else? Right here.
This is primarily for you, Honey. It's really exciting to meet you. I'm a reporter who's been working inside Syria since 2012. And one of the challenges that we're finding is it's becoming, you know, increasingly impossible to ask international or Syrian reporters to continue to work when it's become so dangerous. So I've been in a lot of conversations about, you know, do we send drones with cameras to priority areas or areas that we know human rights violations are being committed regularly? Then, you know, we've also had conversations, do we approach like Facebook or Google, who are starting to bring like balloons and satellites over areas to provide internet access to inaccessible areas. So I guess I wanted to know, in the work that you do, what would be most helpful for your correspondents that are working throughout Syria to help their work make it a little easier for them to continue?
Thank you for the question, and bless you for going inside Syria. Again, it's really complex. It's not what do we do for all Syria. There are pockets now that you, and each to its own, basically, of what you can do. What I would say at large, though, is that Syrian civil society initiatives are in the thousands. Media outlets, since the start of the revolution, are over 100 media outlets that emerged. All of these people need support. You can vet them. You can, you know, see who's doing what. SouriaLi, for example, we have minimal resources. That's why we can't have full-timers all the time. We suffer from the fact that these are mobile transmitters because you can't stay in one place for too long. We would like satellite, for example, because that would be, you know, it would help so much, and this way you can cover all of Syria in that sense. So whatever you may be able to help, please go ahead and do, whether it's drones with cameras or, you know, and finding the truth in such a situation is very difficult because the truth is the first casualty of war. And we need to know the truth, but there are so many truths to what's happening on the inside. But there is a civil society inside. There are people who are working until now documenting humanitarian violations, be it by the regime or rebel faction X, Y, or Z, it doesn't matter. Even when we campaign and we say we want all our detainees, we mean all our detainees, no matter where they are. And there are a lot of, again, people who are out there doing this work, but they're not being recognized. And they're not being supported, whether morally or financially, in that point. And I think those people who remain inside are the heroes. And those who are documenting, they're the heroes. And they need the support, but they're not at the headlines. And international organizations until now are not including them. There's still that gap between policymakers and grassroots level initiatives.
Truth is the first casualty of war. Yes, ma'am. Right here in the front.
Hi. This question is probably more for Sabrina, although everyone has touched upon it, so we can talk about it, I guess. To try and condense this, I think I'm still interested in what you mentioned about struggling to find your way in between your fields and what you were doing. And I think that that sort of is tied in some ways to the idea of how media is changing the status quo, especially when you mentioned the idea of media being essentially a business, and what you are in the business is to some extent empowering people to tell their own stories. But in many ways, that's kind of opposed to how it can work. I believe so. And so I'm curious to hear more about what you all think, because is it, you know, essentially that the job of a journalist isn't to be an activist per se, but the idea of objectivity and sort of staying away from the story, how are you finding true balance, understanding that really, if the idea is to enact change by empowering individuals, that is kind of a destabilization of what media does?
You are inside every weekly staff meeting. This is like something we go around and run around. In terms of objectivity, I think I came up as a journalist. I believe in objectivity, yes. But in practice, I was taking care of my nephew, and he was like using air quotes wrong, and I was like, "Well, I've taught you nothing." Oh yeah, okay, so anyways, objectivity in the digital age. I think it was something that was easier to have a grasp on when media organizations had tighter controls over who could engage on stories. And now there are entire audience engagement divisions of major news organizations. So with that slips, the definition of what is a story widens into having a conversation. And if you're having a conversation, then you're introducing your own point of view, your own unconscious bias, your own unchecked narratives into it. So that makes objectivity slip further and further away. I believe in the goal of objectivity and the intention of objectivity, but in the practice of what media and journalism is today, it is harder to have a grasp on, because being objective is something that also implies having control. And in terms of being an activist, I say this, I was having a conversation with a friend of mine
about mission and narrative, and even in terms of like what's happening with Ferguson and racial justice in this country and how media is playing a role in that, I said to her, I was like, how is ending sexual violence a mission and not common sense? So I kind of like, I'm just gonna take a side on that. And I'm okay with that. I'm asleep.
It's so true, because sometimes we'll deal with issues at CNN, for example, and you're just gonna fall on the side of right. There is no objectivity. You're just right.
Just look at the arc of how racial justice has been covered in this country. I don't wanna get a quote from the Klan. Like, I'm just gonna say black people are awesome. Fair and equal.
But
this is the craft. I mean, yeah. I said this before. Anyone who's ever taken a history class, did your professor not say there's no such thing as pure history? There's no such thing as pure journalism. You choose what's on your front page. You choose what the facts are that are relevant. You have to have a body of experience, and that's where the editorial function comes in. Experienced editors debating with you what is relevant, what's not. Why is that voice a voice worthy of hearing from? Is that voice a credible voice? Is it somebody with an agenda that's more personal than cultural? Or you know, how we vet those voices, the ethical voices. Who decides what's ethical? There you've made a judgment in your, that's a judgment call. And so we have to be very, very careful around this. There is no purity here. So let's not pretend anyone here is going to ever get pure around this or perfect at it. People will make mistakes when they choose to listen to somebody they believe, they want to believe, it's a higher cause. I had a friend who is a great journalist, and was doing a story that a leading feminist opposed. And my friend asked her why, and they said, because you'll hurt the cause.
The cause is not my audience.
It is, but the audience needs to hear the truth. Yeah. Yeah. I don't care who, it's believing that the facts you're sharing are worth sharing and having editors and guides and wise elders tell you that is so as well, not just your own personal whatever.
I see you on the edge of your seat. Jump in.
Yes. A veteran editor who has covered.
Oh, dear. And also now I teach new media at Columbia. And the audience is the stage. We can talk about, I'm an editor, so yes, we need them.
We do, but, we do.
Of you. But so much of us, so consistently, are caught up in our own decision making, and we're not listening. And I think what is so intriguing about what you're doing, Honey, and Yann, is providing a stage where there previously wasn't any, and to the extent that people can listen, and just to accommodate a conversation, not among us as media, but to really start listening and having some of these tools start to drive the story as well. Objectivity is not limiting the participants in a conversation or distilling something down to something is right or wrong. There are many truths, many grays, as we've talked about this morning. So my question, if I can change the subject just a little bit off of us.
Yeah, please.
And talk about our audience a little bit. And could you speak to the dangers or the kind of crossfire that you face in the work that you're doing from various governments or forces that would silence you? What has been that battle?
Yann and Honey.
I can, I'll give you the example of Palestine, okay? Are we allowed to say Palestine in the US or? No, but, look, Hamas, for example, doesn't like what we're doing. Now, the way we're trying to portray women and the way we want women to have a chance and equal rights to men is not the way Hamas sees it. So, of course, we broadcast in the Gaza Strip. Hamas doesn't like it, so, do I care? No, I don't. Are they shutting us down? No, they don't, because we can't. The repeater is not in Gaza, so it's not an issue for us. But I believe that's a way, when we talk about, you measure the impact that we have. The way we measure the impact is you have people who have very different belief than what belief don't like what you're doing, it's probably a way to say, okay, we have impact. Secondly, is audience. We're probably now the third or fourth largest radio in the West Bank and in Gaza, and that's a way how we measure the impact. Three, for me, the most important is 40% of the listeners are men. I don't want it to be a radio for women, only to convince women that violence and that is important. I need need to change, especially in this region, change the way men look at women. And that's why I think, for me, the feminism of the 60s is finished. It's not woman against man. If you want to change something, you need to engage men, and you need to change the way men look at women and change the patriarchal societies in many of those places. So that's...
Well, I'd first say thank God for online. We're everywhere. We're not inside Syria in the sense of, yes, we do have correspondence, or yes, we do have mobile transmitters, and we find a lot of security issues there. Yes, we've had, you know, people that we worked with on the inside who had to flee to Turkey because of, you know, whether it's Jabhat al-Nusra or ISIS. It's not just the regime anymore. We've been blocked so many times. We've been hacked. I still have a Facebook page that's not mine, and Facebook doesn't seem want to do anything about it.
Talk to me afterwards.
Thank you. So there is that, but again, what, you know, what we're all doing, I guess, through all the work that we do, is creating a platform, a space. In when it comes to Syria or even the region, and if you're thinking war-wise. The people need that space to express themselves, to have the freedom to say and do what they don't have the freedom to say and do where they are. That's one. Two, it is that space where they can document what is happening and what has happened to them. And they can recreate that reality that they don't like into a future that they want to see, be it Syria, Palestine, or whichever it is. One of the programs that became successful, although we just did 6 pilots with UK Refuge Drama Productions, is we created a soap opera called We Are All Refugees. And it's based on true stories of refugees in Za'atari camp, how they had to leave their homes, how they fled, what they went through when they arrived, the camps, the tents, the women that were forced to get married, so on and so forth. These are all based on true stories, but it's through a narrative. That's creating a space, one, for those other refugees or other Syrians to say, okay, this is our history being documented through storytelling. Again, it's a part of saying, well, my God, that's my story. This is what we're going through. What are we going to do about it? So these kind of platforms are, you know, especially these media platforms where there's a lot of creativity and narrative in it, are very important for, you know, our past, our present, and where we want to go.
One more point on censorship. Some of you may know Zainab Salbi, who started One for Women. So Zainab now is launching something called Nida. It's a show in the Middle East based on Oprah Winfrey, and she's working with 3 producers of Winfrey. So I was talking to her, we're a group of people to helping her to finance it. Saudi, there are things, if she wants to broadcast in Saudi, there are things she won't talk about, so you have a choice. If she wants to be in Saudi and have an influence there, she knows what she can talk and not talk. So it's common sense in some ways, you know. The radio in Palestine, we're not talking about politics, about the conflict. That's not, you know, what we're there for. So it's about picking your battle and being smart. You know, at the end of the day, you know, you want to know what you want to work on, and so focus on that. And it's not about changing everything. It's changing a few things better than changing nothing.
Right. And I want to throw back to what Honey said earlier. The people who are taking the real risk are the ones in the country,
right,
counting bodies, doing the on-the-ground activism, the correspondence in the country. I was supposed to go to, I'm not going to say where, a couple of weeks ago, and hours before I was supposed to leave, I was supposed to go train some democratic activists, and all of them were arrested. So, like, they are the heroes. I mean, they're since released, but that's just, the negotiating this stuff is only going to get more hard, especially as resources to navigate them, like,
kidnapping and rampant ransom insurance, getting paid to do this sustainably, gets those are the issues that will make it more accessible so that this work can continue. But the people who are in the country who are counting, who are doing this day in and day out and can't leave, those are the people who are the real...
I just wanted to add, sorry, just one more thing and on sustainability and also to what you were saying, Jan, is that this is long-term. Changing societal behaviors, cultural reform, peace building, this is something that you don't, it's not a project. It's something that you need to continue doing forever because it becomes a way of life. And you need to reach a point where there's a normalcy in behavior. It's not like somebody's telling me, you know, women's empowerment or something. It's not that, in a sense.
I a couple things. I was just going to say that in terms of people in country, I would just to echo all that you're saying, having been a classmate since age 18, I could get emotional about Marie Colvin, who was a great journalist killed in Syria. I'd known Marie since first day freshman year, one of my great heroes. Let's not forget the journalists doing this hand-in-hand with those trying to document for other organizations this work, and there are fewer and fewer of them because they're not getting supported, as we know, by these organizations, which is so frightening to me. It's back to what I was talking about, those who are sent in there to document, as journalists, what is happening. And I was just going to say, I just lost my train of thought, but it was something about the grassroots piece of this and the long-termism of it. The older I get, the more I feel like a lot of this question of outcome, you know, ask my great-grandchildren. I mean, I do think we all have to be committed to long-termism, and that's not particularly glamorous, but if you want to honor the grassroots approach, which we're all told, even by the top-down foundations, is really the only way to affect change, it is generations and generations to echo Honey. Honey's seen this. And Honey doesn't think Syria is going to be, there's going to be a glamorous, happy outcome tomorrow. And the work Honey does may echo generations past her. But you do it with the faith that if we all do it, we won't live to see it, but it will happen.
And we have to know that even though we're so go, 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 140 characters or less headline faith. Reading society. One more. In the back. On our tiptoes.
Oh, yeah. Hi. I have a question about how your content gets to people. So in an age where search engine optimization, Twitter, kind of the echo chamber exists in this world, and especially as a millennial, like I don't look to any particular news source, I'm just looking at what my friends or my community is looking at. How has that helped you either penetrate or made it harder for you to penetrate the communities and the audiences that you're trying to change?
I'll give you a quick example. We're working in the Middle East, and there are different numbers, but about 70% of the population is below 35. And the penetration of internet is very, very high, especially on using mobile phone. So we're launching, and Sarah Jean is here, from Lapis. They do social communication. So we're doing a big campaign using social media and cartoons. So 5 minutes, cartoon, very short. The attention span is shortening, and using social media, big campaign on social media. So we're adapting because we know if I want to change things in the Middle East, you know, I need to adapt to my audience, and my audience is very young. And so radio is great, but probably I'm not going to reach the same audience using my radio than using social medias or cartoons or fictions.
Yeah, I mean, totally agree with Jan. This is something that we do as well in SouriaLi. If you recall at the very beginning, I said we use digital art. We're on every social media possible, be it YouTube or, so on and so forth. In fact, there is, right now, we have a storyteller of SouriaLi. His name is Abu Fakir, and this is a folkloric or traditional storyteller that sits in the coffee shops, an older man, so on and so forth. And he's in Paris right now. And this is something that we do through collaboration, by the way, which is why collaboration is very important between not only local but also international initiatives and organizations. So there's another initiative called Under 35, and they have a YouTube channel. They're Syrians, a Syrian director and producer. And we collaborated with them that the Abu Fakir show that's very popular on SouriaLi goes to Paris, and we're filming this right now, and it's going to come out in Ramadan. And he's going to tell the stories of the French Revolution in comparison to the Syrian revolution. So this is one of the, for an example for what you're saying. Social media today or online is very important. In fact, I believe, and correct me if anybody knows more information about this, but Norway in 2016 will no longer have FM frequency. They're going online. So the digital age is the age. It's happening now. In 10 years, that's what everything is turning on to. So being on all of the social media is important. You need to know also, for example, in the MENA region, I believe in Saudi Arabia, the number one, you know, social media platform for them is YouTube. For Kuwaitis, it's Instagram. So you've got so many different audiences. And one last thing to keep in mind, and this is to what everybody was saying here today, is that people today have the power more than ever. With traditional mainstream media before, it was almost a one-way flow of information where I'm just disseminating this to you, but now it's two ways. Every journalist needs a citizen and every citizen needs a journalist. And there's so many options out there that you have the power of choice and you need to make that choice. It's a double-edged sword. Media is, always has been, and more so today. So it's up to you to see, you know, and you just said it. You said it depends on, you know, your community, what your friends send you. You know, so if Jan sends me a link to a New York Times piece, I trust that I trust what he sent me. So I'm going to tweet it because I know, you know, we're like-minded, for example, or Kyle, or so on and so forth. So that's how it's been lately. So it's about, you know, it's your choice at that point.
I think we need to wrap it up. Go ahead, Antonella.
I get the last question.
You do. Go for it.
I have that privilege. Now, I think it was a fantastic example, and it's kind of very naturally to see women journalists in action. Sorry, Jan, but the other panelists. And one of the objectives we are pursuing with the Womanity Foundation is not only to use media through storytelling, edutainment, and other things for women's empowerment, but also to make sure women are working in the media and working in the media in senior positions. And when you see a panel like this, you think, oh yeah, of course, there are lots of really excellent, brilliant women journalists out there, and they're doing it. But my question now is to Brooke, before you wrap it up, Brooke, what is it like to be where you are now, and what was it like to get there as a woman?
I would say, actually, I had a girlfriend who's not a journalist, but she was visiting me at CNN a couple of weekends ago, and she was sitting in my office, and my show had wrapped, and I had, like, there was a woman after another woman who kept coming in, and they all finally left, and she said, wow, you really have this, like, great space here and a community, and I've created it, and I am a big believer. Before I talk about just being a woman journalist, really am a big believer in bringing people up. Because as a woman coming up, it's not always easy to get the elder states women to help you. And so I am a big believer, if you are a good, kind, honorable, lovely lady, I want to help bring you up. And I go out of my way to make my office or my email inbox an open place to help younger women, number one. I think I definitely still have moments, and there are a few of us gals at CNN when we get frustrated over certain non-women being chosen to go certain places. We have some acronyms for that, and it definitely exists still. But listen, the president of CNN's office is literally 20 feet away from me, and I have a wonderful relationship with him, and I have no qualms about getting up and barging in his office and telling him, this just happened, I want to go. I want to be there. I want to be in the field. I want to be on the front lines. So sometimes it's difficult, and my girlfriend colleagues will say, it's one thing when women go bang on a boss's door and say, well, we should be there, versus sometimes men. I think women come off sometimes as complaining, and men seem aggressive and bold, and that's something we have to fight. But I'm willing to fight every day, and I am very aware of having women on my show, female voices. I'm already, like, making mental notes, and I'm getting all your numbers because you'll all be on CNN. but I love it. I really do, and I believe in, at the end of the day, bringing other people, other women with me. So really, with that, just maybe each of us 2 minutes of just final sort of takeaways, notes for anyone. Sabrina, let's start with you.
Yay. I'm sorry, I'm still like glowing from your comments. So I guess my kind of closing thoughts is this: without the internet, I would have been rendered invisible in the media. And I think, and women like me, and women who look like me, and I think it has afforded us a tremendous of opportunity to learn and hear and bear witness to stories that are incredibly unlike our own, and to widen our gap for compassion and humanity. And I also want to say that it's also given us a tremendous opportunity to build our own power. I have a group of girlfriends where we have, I don't know if you have a like an email offline thread where it's just kind of like misogyny check. We kind of do gut checks and check-ins with each other. And one of them recently, you know, pinged and said, I want to do this thing. Should I do this thing? Da da da. It was framed as if she needed to get permission from some like overlord or dude to do this thing that she was perfectly positioned to do. And the chorus roared back at her. It's don't ask for permission. Build your own power. Trust your own voice. You have all of the tools you need. You have everything you need to succeed, literally right at your fingertips. Push back from that inner monologue of needing a permission slip signed from someone, because you have everything you need to tell your own stories and build your own power. That's kind of like my like MO and like call to action every day. So.
The chorus.
There are so many things I'd love to say, but sitting between these two, I do have faith in the future of nonfiction, fact-based storytelling that can move people to change. Which you don't go into journalism to keep things the same. That's one thing we all know. And I also though want to make the case for nonfiction journalism storytelling as its own cause. That those of you that ask, what's the outcome? When you read the New York Times, is someone asking you as you're reading it, what's your outcome? I just want to make the case, it's as old as man, the need to tell stories, the power of storytelling, the hunger for it. And to your point, Sabrina, don't be afraid of what they call the dark stories, that women will, what I have learned, will not shy away from and walk out when you say we're about to tell you some very difficult things. And in fact, the evidence suggests that they feel, I hate the word empowered, but they feel emboldened by it, informed by it, and ready to, and galvanized around it. And that we can humbly share other voices, to your point, bring in more voices, give them the platform, but help them with this platform. And step back more to share this platform that we all have digitally, and for me, actually, also on a live stage. But be humble both about what our role is in it, but also understand the power of it, and that storytelling is the beginning, and it is essential to anything that comes after.
Well, I don't know what to say after all that. Well, I'd echo both of you, and possibly I know I would echo Yann too right now. Well, I guess I'd say if we were to focus on women in the media, and to the word of empowerment, you know, once I heard this lady who said, she's a woman leader in the Philippines, and she said, who am I to empower you? Right. And she's like, we help empower each other by basically being who we are and doing what we do and accomplishing and being determined. And that's why when you interview, like on the show, when I was interviewing women from Rwanda and then a Syrian woman would listen to her story, it's lessons learned from each other, really, and it's bringing each other up, like you were saying. I would like to see more women in the media, not because of a count. It's not we need so many women, but we need to actually recognize them when they're there. How much impact do they have? Are they influencing? Are they, you know, and that's why it's important, and especially in the MENA region, is not just engaging women in the media, as in, you know, presenters or programming or producers, but also engaging the women audience in the sense of, we can't keep, you know, putting women in a second class or in a pigeonhole of, well, they're only going to be interested in fashion and cooking, and we are interested, but is that it? I mean, there are other things that, you know, that's why a lot of women would go to alternative media at this point. So we would love to see more women in the media, because they can help change that narrative. And the less women we have in the media, and those who don't have impact, that means we limit that narrative.
John? I kind of reiterate the point that, you know, there is a lot to be done. You know, we work a lot in the Middle East on how to use media to empower a woman. And it's about creating a role model and changing, you know, talking about the statu quo. Is, you know, you want men to understand that it's great for them and it's great for society to give the same chances. And media is a good way to portray that women can be more than, we work with many women who say they move from their parents to their husband, you know, in their society. And you want them to have the idea that they can be more. Then there is that transition, could be, you know, getting a job, doing something, contributing to society.
So with that, a round of applause for the panel, please.
Say a word of thanks. Thank you very much, Sabrina. I hope we're in touch soon, because we want to code with girls in Afghanistan. So we're counting on you. Kyle, thank you very much. I hope we can find some good stories to tell together from the experiences that we have in the field and that you have. And Honey, we know we're going to be working together more, producing the animation, distributing the animation. And thank you very much, Brooke, for elevating this debate and for all the work that you do. And to you, the audience, thank you very much for coming this morning. And if you want to do something for our 10th anniversary at the Womanity Foundation, you can pledge your Womanity through these little cards that you found on your seats. And pledging your Womanity just means anything you'd like to commit to doing to help empower women. And you can write it on this card, you can send the card to a friend so they can pledge, you can tweet the pledge to us, you can give it to us in any form, by email or anything. We are collecting pledges for our 10th anniversary. So thank you very much, and have a good day.